Hey, what's up, everybody? This is Dante Fortson here with a new segment called White Bottle Wednesdays. So every Wednesday, what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring medicine from the white bottle and show it to everybody, because there are a lot of things being said and a lot of things just aren't adding up to what's being said. So before we get into this very first episode of White Bottle Wednesdays, today's episode is brought to you by the Israelite Apologist Handbook. If you do not yet have the Israelite Apologist Handbook, it is 100% free on blackhistoryinthebible.com. Again, blackhistoryinthebible.com version 2.1 was just released last night. And one quick, thing about version 2.1, I won't get into it all the way, is this section right here, most recent updates. It'll tell you the version. If these versions don't match, it's whichever version is the highest, and this will be fixed later if they don't match. But you can click this drop down box right here and you can now see exactly what was added in the update. This was a minor update, which is why it's version 2.1 and not version 3.0, for those that don't know how updates work in the software world. So check it out. Version 2.1 is available and you guys can go through here and see the new stuff that has been added. Again, blackhistoryinthebible.com. All right, so if you want to support, hit that thumbs up button, hit that subscribe button, and click the notification bell. You can also support by going to patreon.com/DanteFortson, Cash App, #BHITB, and the PayPal link is in the description. So today's episode, we're going to talk about Deuteronomy 28. And here's what I find interesting. There have been things said such as Israelites are the only people that interpret Deuteronomy 28:68 the way we do. Before us, it wasn't viewed as prophecy, which is not true. I actually did a video showing that at least since the 1600s, Europeans viewed it as prophecy. I also showed a video of Perry Stone and another man on there talking about using the Old Testament as prophecy. And today I have a different white bottle that's going to talk about Deuteronomy 28 being prophecy, and not only that, future prophecy. Now, to be very clear, Chuck Missler, who we're going to be looking at, tries to apply a lot of it to the Holocaust, because he believes that, or believed that, the other people in the land of Israel today were the people of the book. And so the important part here is that he did interpret it as prophecy. Another important part is that he does not interpret Egypt as literal Egypt. He interprets it as another place. And there are a few more things I'm going to point out as well. So we're going to keep this one super short and, straight to the point. So I'll read these few verses right here that he's going to deal with. We're not going to watch his whole video. The link to his entire video will be in the description. So that way you can go back and watch the whole Deuteronomy 28 series that he has for yourself. So these are the verses in question. I'm going to give you a little bit of background on Chuck Missler, and I'm going to let his thing play. And this is the background is for people who don't know. It says, and this is Deuteronomy 28:64-68. And the Lord shall scatter thee among all people, from the one end of the earth even unto the other, and there thou shalt serve gods which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. And among these nations shalt thou find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have rest. But the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart, and failing of eyes, and sorrow of mind. And thy life shall hang And thy life shall hang in doubt before thee, and thou shalt fear day and night, and shall have none assurance of thy life. In the morning thou shalt say, would God it were even, and at even thou shalt say, would God it were morning, for the fear of thine heart wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes which thou shalt see. And the Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again. And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you. So that's what we're going to deal with real quick. For those that don't know who Chuck Missler is, this is Chuck Missler right here. As you can see, he is not an Israelite. He is not black. He does not teach a pro-black theology. And this quote right here, one of my favorite quotes, and Chuck Missler was one of my biggest influences in getting into the Bible in general and then wanting to teach the Bible later on. I listened to a lot of Chuck Missler throughout high school. So even now I can still say he's probably been the biggest influence on me when it comes to ministry. It says the New Testament is in the Old Testament concealed. The Old Testament is in the New Testament revealed. He used to say that a lot. And if you guys want to know more about Chuck Messler, you can go to his website, chuckmessler.com. Link will be in the description. And his Wikipedia page. Chuck Messler was an American author, evangelical Christian, Bible teacher, engineer, and businessman. So he was an evangelical Christian. He wasn't teaching Hebrew Israelism or Black Hebrew Israelism, as some would like to term it. He was not part of a camp, because as I said, some people will call this camp doctrine. They will say, well, the camps are the one that started this, and it's simply not true, which is why I brought out a bottle of the white medicine. So now, this is his other site, koinoniahouse.com, or khouse, I'm sorry, khouse.org, but Koinonia House is the name of it. And he's been online for a long time. When I first jumped online, he was the first person I saw with MP3s and MP4s that you could download. And I'm talking, this is early 2000s. And you could, you know, do e-commerce on this site. It's changed a lot since then, but it is what it is. He was a pioneer in his field for sure, especially when it came to content creation. He was creating content long before content creators were a thing. You could get on this site back in the early 2000s, and there would be easily 100 products for sale, videos, audios, and books, and everything else. All right, so now that you know a little bit of background about Chuck Messler, you can go do more research into him on your own if you want to. Let's go ahead and listen to what he has to say about Deuteronomy. This is his study number 12, Deuteronomy 27 through 28 by Chuck Messler. This was added February 16th, 2014. So here we go.
Wherewith thine enemy shall distress thee in all thy gates, the tender and delicate woman among you, which would not adventure to set the sole of her foot upon the ground for delicateness and tenderness.
I started back just a few verses just so he could lead into it, so you guys could hear, you know, how he's leading into what he's about to say, so that way people won't say that we took it out of context.
Her eye shall be evil toward the husband of her bosom, and toward her son, and toward her daughter, and toward her young one that cometh out from between her feet, and toward her children which she shall bear, for she shall eat them for want of all the things secretly in the siege and straitness wherewith thine enemy shall distress thee in thy gates. If thou wilt not observe to do all the words of this law that are written in this book, that thou mayest fear this glorious and fearful name, the Lord thy God, then the Lord will make thy plagues wonderful, or awesome is probably a better translation, and the plagues of thy seed, even great plagues of long continuance and sore sicknesses of long continuance. Moreover, he will bring upon thee all the diseases of Egypt which thou wast afraid of, and they shall cleave unto thee. Also every sickness and every plague which is not written in the book of this law, them will the Lord bring upon thee until thou be destroyed. And ye shall be left few in number, whereas ye were as the stars of heaven for multitude, because thou wouldst not obey the voice of the Lord thy God. It shall come to pass that as the Lord rejoice over you, to do you good, and to multiply you, so the Lord will rejoice over you to destroy you, and to bring you to naught. And ye shall be plucked from off the land whither thou goest to possess it. There's comments I could make, but I don't think I need to. It's pretty graphic. And the Lord shall scatter thee among all the people.
Now here's where we're coming into the verses. We're going to focus on what he says about these verses.
From one end of earth, at one end of the earth, even to the other. And there thou shalt serve other gods, which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone. Boy, in just a few strokes, Moses summarizes the prophecies of the centuries.
Now notice what he said. In just a few strokes, Moses summarizes the prophecies of the centuries. Moses prophesies. Remember, a lot of people keep saying this isn't a prophecy. This isn't a prophecy. But one more time, Chuck Messler was an author, evangelical Christian, Bible teacher, engineer, and businessman. Chuck Messler had hundreds of thousands, possibly millions of people who listened to him worldwide. He was an evangelical Christian, and even he was calling this prophecy. But let's keep listening.
Among these nations thou shalt find no ease, neither shall the sole of thy foot have a rest, but the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart and failing of eyes and sorrow of mind. And thy life shall hang in doubt before thee. And thou shalt fear day and night and shalt have no assurance of thy life. In the morning thou shalt say, would God it were even. In the even thou shalt say, would God it were morning. For the fear of thine heart wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes which thou shalt see. The Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, and by the way thereof. And by Egypt here I think is used idiomatically, but that's okay.
Wait, he said Egypt there is used idiomatically. Egypt there is used idiomatically. Let me just go back just a little.
But the Lord shall give thee there a trembling heart and failing of eyes and sorrow of mind. And thy life shall hang in doubt before thee. And thou shalt fear day and night and shalt have no assurance of thy life. In the morning thou shalt say, would God it were even. In the even thou shalt say, would God it were morning. For the fear of thine heart wherewith thou shalt fear, and for the sight of thine eyes which thou shalt see. The Lord shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, and by the way thereof. And by Egypt here I think is used idiomatically, but that's okay.
Idiomatically. And let's go ahead and see what idioms are. We're going to listen to Idioms for Kids real quick and see what he meant by the phrase idiomatically, because I don't want anybody saying we took anything out of context. So we're going to, you know, try to figure out what this definition is.
Uh-oh, what's this?
Fair use.
These look like storm clouds. Sure enough, it's starting to rain. Wow, a really heavy rain. Now, not everyone enjoys the rain, especially if you aren't completely prepared. But these kids know what they're doing. They have their rain boots and everything. During a rainstorm, you might hear someone say, "It's raining cats and dogs." Have you ever heard someone say that before? Huh. It might sound like a weird thing for people to say, because we know that it isn't actually raining cats and dogs.
All right, I'm going to let the video play again, but the thing being described isn't literal is the whole point of this video. I'm going to let it play just a little bit more so you guys can hear it in context. But the point is, the thing being described isn't literal. So Chuck Missler said he believes Egypt is used as an idiom, which means he doesn't believe it is literal Egypt, but somewhere else.
If it was, Mr. Whiskers would be terrified. And okay, yeah, I would be too. Now, why would someone say it's raining cats and dogs when clearly it is not raining cats and dogs? Well, that's what this video is all about. It's all about something kind of weird in language called idioms. Idioms. Okay, what are idioms? Well, idioms are phrases that don't mean what they literally say. They have a special meaning. When someone says it's raining cats and dogs, they mean it is raining heavily.
All right. Hopefully y'all get the point. This is a 6-minute video. Y'all can go back and watch it yourselves if you still don't understand how closely America is linked to Egypt. Now, Chuck Missler doesn't believe America's Egypt. I personally believe the Egypt reference is linked to America. Chuck Missler believes it's linked somewhere else. And my point again in showing this video is so that when people come along and say that Israelites are teaching camp doctrine and nobody else believed this, we can now point to the fact that there were hundreds of thousands, possibly millions of evangelical white Christians that did in fact take Deuteronomy 28 as prophecy. They did not take Egypt as literal, and they believed that it referred to someplace else. So let me go ahead and go back to Chuck Missler, and I'm gonna let him finish saying what he says.
By the way thereof, where I speak unto thee, thou shalt see it no more again, and there shall be sold, and ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you. I have some pictures here.
Now, they don't show the pictures on here, but what Chuck Missler is doing is he's actually showing Holocaust pictures and they didn't put him up online for everybody to see, but he does show Holocaust pictures. So keep in mind that what he is talking about is the Holocaust as a fulfillment or possible fulfillment of this Deuteronomy 28 section that he called prophecy out of his own mouth. So he believes this points to the other people in the land, because again, that's what everybody was being told. That's what the most of the world accepts. And so they aren't even looking at the transatlantic slave trade. But just keep that in mind as you listen to what he says. He's talking about the Holocaust that happened in Europe with Hitler.
The more recent vintage of Europe, in the late 30s, early 40s, slave labor, organized for the trains.
Now, he mentions slave labor in Europe, but he overlooks the slave labor here that happened in America.
And the many, many camps that can't even be captured on film in terms of their scope and size. I don't need to identify them. They're all familiar to us in one form or another.
And real quick, before I forget, now the reason, one more time, I said it before, the reason he's bringing up slave labor in the 30s and 40s is because he's pointing back to Deuteronomy as that being a possible fulfillment of Deuteronomy 28, which means, as he said, he believed it was prophecy that pointed to future events, and he did not believe Egypt was literal Egypt.
We all remember the darkness that was over Europe in the late 30s and early 40s. The crowds, the hangings, the electric fences, the ovens, each oven can do 4,700 per day, and it wasn't enough to keep up with the traffic. Auschwitz's famous gate, Arbeit macht frei, work makes you free. And the cattle cars. And the bodies. They look like a Renaissance sketch from Dante's Inferno, don't they? The leftover glasses, the leftover shoes, anything that could make merchandise.
Now see, he's describing what happened during the Holocaust, but they're overlooking all of the stuff that happened to black people for 400 years. They take that small little section of the Holocaust. It was a tragedy. However, nothing that happened during that few years of the Holocaust will ever equate to the 400 years of what our people have been through here on this continent. And they like to overlook this. And again, they weren't looking towards us, because every time we start talking about us in context of scripture, we're told to drop it and leave the ethnicity alone. But nobody else is told to do that. They clearly believe these people, the 1948 people, are linked to the people of the book. And yet when this evangelical white Christian says so, nobody tells him to drop the ethnicity stuff, or that ethnicity isn't important, or he's elevating their ethnicity over God. Nobody said anything to him about it. But let's keep going. He says some interesting stuff here at the end.
The children that had experiments put on them while they're alive. On it goes. Heavy stuff. Heavy stuff. The diaspora and its conclusion in what we call the Holocaust. Very contemporary. Actually, very symptomatic of smaller issues all through history, but obviously climaxed in a very real way in Holocaust in Germany. The Holocaust apparently took one Jew in three.
Now, get those numbers. He says it took one in three. I encourage you guys to look up the incarceration rate and, yeah, get into the statistics here in America and see how closely they match some of the Bible statistics. But I believe his next statement, now this is my opinion, I believe that the next statement he makes is because he doesn't believe that the Holocaust 100% fits Deuteronomy 28, the fulfillment, which is why I said he points to it as a possibility. But I also think he's hesitant because he doesn't consider that the situation of black people in America may have been or was definitely worse than what happened during the Holocaust. And so those numbers aren't even in his consideration. But listen to what he says about the numbers. He said the first Holocaust took 1 in 3. Listen to this.
On the planet Earth. If you're interested in this area, I encourage you sometime on the internet, just look up the diaspora and its conclusion and what we call the
I went back a little.
Holocaust. Very contemporary. Actually very symptomatic of smaller issues all through history, but obviously climaxed in a very real way in Holocaust in Germany. The Holocaust apparently took 1 Jew in 3 on the planet Earth. If you're interested in this area, I encourage you sometime on the internet, just look up the Holocaust. It's astonishing to see the sites that are there, the pictures that are there, the documents there. The SS reports, how they can't keep up with the traffic, even with all the technology they're trying to apply and so forth. The reality of it. And as you do that, though, you want to read Zechariah 13, 8, and 9. By calling that to an attention on a radio broadcast, the Jewish Anti-Defamation League has labeled me as an anti-Semite. I didn't say it. Zechariah said it.
So hold on. He was labeled as an anti-Semite. Let me go back just a little.
Anti-Semite.
Oh, a little bit
I
more.
Didn't. Documents there. The SS reports, how they can't keep up with the traffic, even with all the technology they're trying to apply and so forth. The reality of it. And as you do that, though, you want to read Zechariah 13, 8, and 9.
Let's read that. Zechariah 13, 8, and 9. Let's just read it for our edification. All right, now we got some YouTube magic happening there. Now, a lot of y'all talk about the two-thirds. A lot of people come in and say two-thirds won't make it. Two-thirds won't make it. That is something Israelites have been saying. Now, Chuck Missler just said he was labeled as anti-Semitic for reading this. Zechariah 13, 8, and 9. And it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die, but the third shall be left therein. And I will bring the third part through the fire, and I will refine them as silver is refined, and will try them as gold is tried. They shall call on my name, and I will hear them. I will say, it is my people. And they shall say, the Lord is my God. I believe that's what a lot of people are afraid of. God will hear us one more time. And I will bring the third part of them through the fire, and will refine them as silver is refined, and will try them as gold is tried. They shall call on my name, and I will hear them. I will say, it is my people, and they shall say, the Lord is my God. All right, so now Chuck Missler said he was labeled as anti-Semitic for reading this. So I'm gonna go ahead and press play.
By calling that to an attention on a radio broadcast, the Jewish Anti-Defamation League has labeled me as an anti-Semite. I didn't say it. Zechariah said it, because the next one is going to take 2 out of 3. It's not the last of it. Daniel.
You heard him, right? He said the next one will take 2 out of 3. Two-thirds. I'm just saying. What we talk about as Israelites, it is not, well, let me go back. There's nothing new under the sun. Let me say it that way. When they're trying to say this is new doctrine, this is from 2014. Most of us say we didn't even come into the awakening till 2015. So how is it a year prior to most people's awakening that we have an evangelical Christian talking about this stuff, and yet now that we're talking about it, suddenly it's camp doctrine, it's new doctrine, and nobody was talking about it before? This is why I bring the big white bottles.
I mentioned Daniel 12, that there's a time of trouble such as the world never seen or ever would see again. Jesus quotes from that as being that period that will be the last 3.5 years of that 7-year period that we know from Gabriel as the 70th week of Daniel. There is a time coming that's going to make even the Holocaust look pale.
I would submit the transatlantic slave trade pales the Holocaust by comparison.
As we stand back and we watch the rise of anti-Semitism in Europe, again, you wonder, don't they ever learn?
We can see the rise of anti-Semitism happening right now against black people that claim to be Israel. Because if we're right, then everything that they've been saying and doing, the opposition, is indeed anti-Semitism. And so far, all evidence tells us that we are right. So we are seeing the rise of anti-Semitism. Listen, he's bringing it all out.
And yet we also, if we're sensitive, we can also see it even here in the United States on the rise.
And again, he's not talking about us. He's talking about those other people, but he's spot on. We can see it here in the United States as well.
And part of the tragedy is that anti-Semitism emerges within the Christian body because of Augustine.
Oh, look at there. He done named a church father. Anti-Semitism rises within the Christian body because of Augustine.
And a theology which argues that the Jews were the one that crucified Christ and that somehow the church inherits the promises to Israel and so forth. That is not only bad biblical doctrine, it's an introduction and an introduction to all kinds of heresies.
Wait. He said that's bad biblical doctrine and an introduction to all kinds of heresies. We got questions now. This white evangelical Christian is calling what Mike Holloway and them teach over there bad doctrine and introduction into all kinds of heresies.
So forth. That is not only bad biblical doctrine. It's an introduction and an introduction to all kinds of heresies. It also...
Hold on, let me go back.
You can map the path.
One more time. And I'm not taking shots at Mike Holloway. Shout out to Mike Holloway. I mean, but he does teach it. So, I mean, it is what it is. He's free to respond to this video and address Chuck Missler's accusations about what they teach. I'm not making them. I'm just pointing out what this white evangelical Christian is saying about what is being taught by many of these Christians, especially in the black Christian church out here.
There is a time coming that's going to make even the Holocaust look pale. As we stand back and we watch the rise of anti-Semitism in Europe, again, you wonder, don't they ever learn? And yet we also, if we're sensitive, we can also see it even here in the United States on the rise. And part of the tragedy is that anti-Semitism emerges within the Christian body because of Augustine. And a theology which argues that the Jews were the one that crucified Christ and that somehow the church inherits the promises to Israel and so forth. That is not only bad biblical doctrine, it's an introduction and an introduction to all kinds of heresies. It also, you can map the path from Auschwitz, from Augustine to Auschwitz.
Oh, shots fired. He then said you can map the path from Augustine to Auschwitz. That's the Holocaust. He is blaming one of the church fathers for the Holocaust. This white evangelical Christian, let me repeat, is blaming one of the church fathers for the Holocaust. And yet they get mad at Israelites when we have something to say about the church fathers. Apparently there are other people out there who have beef with at least one of the church fathers. But I'm going to let this keep playing.
And it's happening again. Be careful as you read your Bible and understand that Israel, God is not finished with Israel yet.
God is not finished with Israel yet. That's what an evangelical Christian just said. God is not finished with Israel yet. And yet we hear other people teaching that he is. Somebody is lying. Somebody is not telling the truth. But let's keep going.
They have a destiny. Their origins, their ups, their downs, and their destiny are detailed in the Old and New Testament. And Paul spends three chapters in his definitive work, which we call the Book of Romans. Some people call it the Gospel according to Paul. Chapters 9, 10, and 11, Paul hammers again and again, is God finished with Israel? God forbid! And he goes on to talk about their past in chapter 9, their present in chapter 10, their future in chapter 11. We need to understand that. That doesn't mean we need to endorse all Israel's policies. That's not the point. But we should pray for Israel. We need to support them as we can in a humanitarian sense.
Wait. So now, when it's the other people, when they think it's the other people, they need to pray for Israel, and they need to support in the humanitarian sense. They need to pray for Israel and support in the humanitarian sense. That's when they believe it's those other people. But when it's when it comes to us, black people saying it, what are we told? Put your culture down. It doesn't matter. You're putting culture over Christ. But when it's the other people, they're told to pray for Israel and support in a humanitarian sense. Let me just walk it back just a little and let y'all hear that again.
Future in chapter 11. We need to understand that. That doesn't mean we need to endorse all Israel's policies. That's not the point. But we should pray for Israel. We need to support them as we can in a humanitarian sense. We're called to do that. They're a special people, and they still are.
What? They're a special people, and they still are. This is from a white evangelical Christian. I'm going to start enjoying these White Bottle Wednesdays. Y'all make sure y'all share this video. There's no reason y'all shouldn't be sharing this video right now. This right here is pretty much everything we've been pointing out. It's coming out the mouth of a white evangelical Christian. So now they either have to label him as a heretic or they have to stop lying on us, which, I mean, they don't have to, but we can keep showing this video. Y'all make sure y'all hit the thumbs up button, share this video.
Despite the fact that they are blinded to the reality of their Messiah, which is exactly what Isaiah, what will come up in Deuteronomy, which Isaiah talks about and Paul builds on in chapter 11 of Romans. So,
but many of us aren't blinded anymore. Remember, he's talking about those people over there. Many of us are not blinded about who we are, nor are we blinded about the Messiah. The blindness is falling away. And I believe that's what they are scared of. Israel is starting to remember and bring God to mind. We're starting to bethink ourselves. Shout out to Jordan and Plummer for going over there, always dealing with those people over there. I don't know how they do it. But yeah, that's starting to happen, and it has these people worried. And we're hearing it from the mouth of a white evangelical Christian that was, you know, a major influence on many other Christians, not just white.
So with that, let's stand for a closing prayer, and we'll have a break before the next session.
All right. So now, y'all heard it from Chuck Missler's mouth, white evangelical Christian. He had a lot to say. Rewind this video. I kept it short on purpose. Make sure you share this video if you want to support. Go to patreon.com/DanteFortson. You can always hit the Cash App with hashtag BHITB. And make sure you hit the thumbs up button before you leave. And make sure you subscribe. Hit the notification bell. Turn on all notifications so you don't miss any future videos. White Bottle Wednesdays. First episode over. More episodes to come. So with that said, till next time, I'm out.